So we've finished up our discussion of covectors. In this video, we're going to be talking about our third example of a tensor, which are linear maps. So linear maps are transformations that take a vector as an input and produce some new vector as an output. So just like I did with vectors and covectors, to introduce linear maps, I'm going to start with a coordinate definition, where linear maps are arrays of numbers. Then I'm going to give a geometrical definition, where you can think of linear maps in terms of pictures. And finally, I'm going to give you an abstract definition, which is purely algebraic, and in some sense, this is the best or the truest definition of linear maps. So I'm going to introduce these definitions, and I'm also going to show you how they are all related to each other. So the coordinate representation of linear maps ends up being matrices, a matrix being a two-dimensional array of numbers. So just as column vectors are the coordinate representation of vectors, and row vectors are the coordinate representation of covectors, matrices are the coordinate representation of linear maps. So let's take a look at how matrices transform vectors. So here we have a 2x2 matrix acting on a 2x1 column vector. And the way we determine the output vector is we use the standard matrix multiplication rules. So what that means is, first we take the dot product of the column vector with the first row of the matrix, and then we take the dot product of the column vector with the second row of the matrix, and the output ends up being the column vector 2, 0. Now, it might be confusing to understand what a matrix is doing just by looking at the numbers inside the matrix, but there's an easy interpretation for what all these numbers mean. Notice that if I use the column vector 1, 0 as the input, I'll get the first column of the matrix as the output. And if I put in the column vector 0, 1 as the input, I'll get the second matrix column as the output. Now these column vectors 1, 0, and 0, 1, these are sort of like copies of the basis vectors e1 and e2. And I say that these are like copies because of this very important point here. Linear maps transform vectors, but linear maps do not transform the basis. So when we transform vectors using a linear map, the basis isn't changing. We aren't moving the basis. While the output vector might be different than the input vector, we're still going to be measuring the output vector using the same basis. But with that said, with matrices, the ith column tells you where to map a copy of the ith basis vector. So let's take a look at that visually. So here we have a basis e1, e2, and vectors v and w, which are sort of like copies of the e1 and e2 basis vectors. And here we have a matrix with the first column 5, 3, and the second column negative 1, 4. So where would this matrix send the vector v, which is like a copy of the first basis vector? Well, we just look back at the first column of the matrix, which represents the vector 5, e1 plus 3, e2, and that's what the output of the linear map looks like for v. So L of v is equal to this vector here. And if we ask what this matrix does to W, which is a copy of the second basis vector, well, that's just the second matrix column, which gives us negative 1 E1 plus 4 E2, and that vector looks like that. So that's L of W. And once again, note that the basis vectors haven't moved because linear maps don't change the basis. We're still measuring the output vectors with the same basis. Okay, so matrices are the coordinate interpretation of linear maps. Let's try and get a more geometrical definition. So the geometrical definition says that linear maps are spatial transforms that keep lines parallel, keep lines evenly spaced, and keeps the origin stationary. So to get an idea of what that looks like visually, let's start with a 2D space here with a bunch of grid lines overlaid on top. And here we have three examples of linear maps. So this linear map is basically a stretch in the horizontal direction. This linear map here is like a rotation. And this linear map is doing a sort of a skew transformation, which you could think of as maybe like a rotation in this direction followed by a stretch along this axis. And as we can see in all of these cases, the grid lines in the output space are still parallel to each other. They're all evenly spaced, even if the spacing might be different than the input space, and the origin hasn't moved. So these are examples of the types of things that linear maps can do, and I'll just mention quickly here that translations are not actually linear maps under this definition. Even though translations keep grid lines parallel and evenly spaced, translations do move the origin, so translations are not actually true linear maps. Okay, so that's a geometric definition that we can visualize. Finally, I'm going to give an abstract definition, which, as usual, might seem confusing at first, but it's actually the best definition that we can give. So abstractly, a linear map is a function which maps vectors to vectors. So in this case, we have a linear map L mapping vectors from a vector space V to a vector space W. A lot of the examples I've shown and will show in the future involve linear maps where the input and output spaces are the same, so maps going from V to V, but in general, the input and output spaces can be different. And also, linear maps obey these two properties here, that we can add the inputs or add the outputs of the linear map and get the same answer. And also, we can scale the input or scale the output and also get the same answer. And so this is the same thing we had with covectors, and these two properties here are called linearity. So both covectors and linear maps are linear functions. The only difference is that covectors output a scalar, and linear maps output vectors. Okay, and you might ask, how the heck did people come up with this abstract definition? The other two definitions seem a little more concrete, but this one seems to come a little bit out of nowhere. So I'm going to show you how the abstract definition relates back to the other definitions that we saw. So here we have this abstract property of linear maps that says we can add the inputs or add the outputs and get the same answer. So to show the geometrical meaning of this, I'm going to draw the input vectors on this grid. So here we have the vector V in green and the vector W in purple, and there's some V plus W all right in black. Now here are those three examples of linear maps which I showed, the stretch, the rotate, and the skew, and I'm going to show you how these three linear maps obey this algebraic property up here. So first I'll draw the green vector V in all these output spaces. So basically I'm going to stretch V, rotate V, and skew V. And now I'm going to do the same thing for the purple vector W, so stretch W, rotate W, and skew W. And last of all, I'm going to do the same thing with this black vector, so stretch V plus W, rotate, and skew. So you can see here in all these output spaces, the addition law still works. The transformation of V plus the transformation of W is the same thing as the transformation of the sum V plus W. So this abstract rule, even though it's algebraic, it still describes the linear maps that we've been talking about all along. And I'm going to do the same thing for the scaling rule. We can scale the input or scale the output to get the same answer. So in the input space, I'm going to draw this vector V in green, and I'm also going to draw the scaled version 2V here in black. So again, I'll transform the vector V according to these three rules, stretch, rotate, skew, and now I'll transform 2V, stretch, rotate, skew. And as you can see, the scaling rule in the output space is still obeyed. So scaling and then transforming is the same thing as transforming and then scaling. So this abstract rule just describes the transformations we've been talking about all along. So hopefully we can see how the abstract and geometrical definitions are related to each other, but we still don't really understand where the coordinate definition comes in. So this formula for matrix multiplication, it can seem really weird if you don't know the reasoning behind it. And it turns out that the matrix multiplication rule actually comes from this abstract definition that we introduced before. So to show that, let's start off by saying that we have a linear map L that acts on a vector V to produce some output vector W. And if we expand the vector V into its components, we get this. And by applying the linearity rules of L, we get this. Now, this L of E1 and L of E2, these are just vectors, right? So we might ask, how can we express these vectors in terms of the basis E1 and E2? And I'm kind of making a simplifying assumption here. I'm assuming that L is a function from V to V, so the input vector space is the same as the output vector space. So since the output vector space V still has the basis E1 and E2, that means we can still write these output vectors as linear combinations of the same old basis E1 and E2. So I've done that here, and the coefficients of these linear combinations, L11, L21, and so forth, these ones and twos are just labels. So I've chosen to write one label on top and the other label on the bottom for a reason. I'll get to why I did that later, but the important thing is that these L coefficients help us build up the output vectors of the linear map using the E basis vectors. All right, so I can rewrite the output vectors as linear combinations of the basis, and I can switch things around here to group the terms by basis vector. And now, since I have W written as a linear combination of the basis vectors, these coefficients are really just the components of W, W1 and W2. And so now we've derived how to transform the V coefficients into the W coefficients using these formulas here. And these formulas here, these are really just what you get when you do the standard 2x2 matrix multiplied by a 2x1 column vector. Okay, so to sum all that up, if we have a linear map L that transforms a vector V into another vector W, like this, where W can be written as a linear combination of basis vectors, and we know how L transforms basis vectors, or maybe it would be better to say, we know how L transforms basis vector copies using these L coefficients. And so that means we can transform the V components into the W components using these formulas here. And if we repeat this argument for any number of dimensions, if we have a linear map L in n dimensions, we would get all the L coefficients from this formula here. Then we can transform the V components into the W components using this formula here. And once again, this formula that we've derived is just the standard matrix multiplication formula for multiplying matrices and vectors together. So what we've done is we've derived the matrix multiplication formulas just from the abstract linearity properties of linear maps. So if you've ever wondered why the matrix multiplication formula works the way it does, it's just the direct result of the abstract linearity properties of linear maps. All right, so that sums up what linear maps are. Next, I'm going to talk about the transformation rules that linear maps undergo when we change basis.